Rose-colored glasses are off. It's time to get real. Yet we remain hopeful still. This is the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. I am your host, Temitayo Osinubi. Let's get to it. Welcome to episode 17 of the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. This week, I had the absolute delight of chatting with one of my favorite digital marketers, Lorrie Thomas Ross. Lorrie is the author of the 36-hour course to online marketing by McGraw-Hill. She taught web marketing, social media marketing, and search engine marketing at the UC Berkeley Extension. She's also the CEO and marketing therapist at Web Marketing Therapy, her own digital agency. As if that wasn't enough, she did myself and my co-author the high honor of writing the foreword for our book, Beyond Buzzwords: Social Media, Mobile, and Other Marketing Buzzwords Ain't the Half of It, which you can pick up on Amazon.com as well as ThinkBeyondBuzzwords.com. She has done an absolute ton of marketing videos for Lynda.com, which is how I found her when I first reached out to her. And in this interview, her spirit really shines through, and you're going to find out quick, fast, in a hurry why she is one of my absolute faves. So without further ado, let's hop into our interview with Lorrie Thomas Ross. Lorrie, thanks so much for taking the time.
Happy to be with you.
So you are a bona fide expert. You've spoken at many events, had your name on the Jumbotron in New York City, but the road to the top tends to be a winding one. So tell us that story. Take us on that journey. When did you first get bit by the bug, and how did you become enchanted with digital marketing?
You know, it's so funny because I don't think of myself as the uber geek that some people think I am, and I speak geek, but I am a lover of people first and foremost. My background before I got into digital marketing was in retail, high-end couture, a lot of personal relationships. I would go into people's homes and do all that. I just find entrepreneurs fascinating, and whether I was working for corporations and helping brands or helping people, which often become the voice of the brand, the tools to me are so secondary. Do I love them? Yes. Are they far more economical than traditional media? Yes. But my passion for digital marketing is solely to support the passionate people who are behind these brands and these businesses. There's an art and science to marketing, and I just feel like these tools, when driven with intention and the right purpose, can just be phenomenal. But my gosh, I mean, I feel old as I say this. I got into the dot-com world in 1999, and oh yeah, we partied like it was 1999. It's been, right. I certainly not a merry-go-round of a career. It's been a roller coaster. It's, you know, dot-com boom, dot-com bust, and now we're in an era of social media, which didn't exist when I was first teaching all of this stuff. So it's, ups, downs, highs, lows, stable times, crazy times. But when you love what you do, you know, you ride all the changes in technology and all the trends.
Absolutely. So tell us a little bit more about when the honeymoon was over. Like, when did you become disenchanted? Not necessarily disillusioned, but when did that sort of shiny veneer come off? And like, okay, when this became real? It's kind of like marriage, right? When you first get married, you're so in love and this person can do no wrong. Then you find out that they snore like a dying moose and fart and just all this other stuff. So when did it get real for you?
Oh my gosh. You know, I am such a realist, and you know, I love your marriage analogy. Yeah, like sometimes life isn't sexy, right? You know, you whether you're getting ready, you're reading the book or watching some expert's podcast, and you're like, ooh, make money from home, or, you know, I can do all this, whatever. Yeah, but the reality is marriage takes work. You got to roll up your sleeves, and doing the dishes isn't sexy. Putting the laundry away isn't sexy. Digital marketing, what I do at Web Marketing Therapy, which is our business, and my team and I are dedicated to stress-free digital marketing. We do a lot of unsexy stuff, and we laugh about it. We're like, okay, I just spent my morning taking someone off of Facebook and re-adding them because that was a simple trigger to get her to use your page. Like, was that sexy? Hell no.
Right.
Am I getting into sites and debugging things? Yeah. my first phase of being disenchanted was in the dot-com boom. As an online salesperson, I was selling those obnoxious banner ads that flash all over. And I'm really sorry about that. I'm in, feel like a recovering salesperson in online advertising. I would ask my clients, what are you doing once these people are getting to your site? How is it working? Are you collecting their email address? And they were like, no, you're just the salesperson, Lorrie. You just sell those clicks and go make the money. And I was like, but what about the relationship? What about this? And it was like, and I'd say, you know, your landing page, if it reiterated the message in your ad, would probably convert better. And it was like, I was like, okay, you know, I just like my job too much and I don't want to just do this one pocketed thing. And in the dot-com boom, I was completely disillusioned with the money, the stupid money that was thrown at advertising. And it was like spray and pray. That was the approach. And it was just so mindless and so soulless. And I actually left. I left one of the top online advertising networks right after they went public. I uploaded all my campaigns. I handed out the contracts to my fellow salespeople. Best way to leave a job. They're like, thanks for free money. I'm like, mwah, hugs and kisses. I went back to college, took my old job back in retail management, and planned on being an elementary school teacher. I mean, I was like that disillusioned that I was like, I'm out of the game. See ya. Like no more. Wow. Kept getting recruited back into it. And the times when I am the most disillusioned today is when an organization is so focused on the tools. Now we want to talk about the technology. We want to talk, do we want this program or this? Well, how are we going to use it? What are we doing here? What's the long-term plan? In the long-term plan to maximize relationships in organizations that cannot talk about the art and the heart of marketing and they just want to geek out, that's when I'm like, I'm walking, because the classics of relationships will always be there. You know, the tools are going to change, right? I mean, look at modern life. I mean, you know, the rules of relationships have evolved and, you know, it's not the old school, you know, woman stays home, dad goes to work. Now we've got dual income households, dad often stays home, you know, mom does the career, whatever, you know, and vice versa. We've got, you know, two moms and two dads and it's amazing and just beautiful. There's life will change and evolve. Rules will change and evolve. Digital marketing is always going to change and evolve. But if your heart is in it for the right reasons, then you can always weather anything.
Thank you for sharing that. That's crazy that they put you through that. And how selfless just to give free money. I like you even more now. I'm like, damn, that was really great.
I always, you know, I have always been that overly responsible person where I just couldn't, I've never left a company without wrapping things up or been accessible to an employer that has gone, oh, we're really sorry you're going, but hey, can we call you a week later or 2 weeks later? Yes, of course. That's my style. I'm, you know, it's relationships. I always believe in doing your best, doing the right thing. So I want to take care of my customers. And gosh forbid, I resigned and, you know, did my IPO party and left. I wanted to make sure that there was no hiccups when I left. And so I had everything queued up and worked late and got everything set. And I handed it out to salespeople that I loved. I mean, I was on an incredible team and I just was like, okay, this client's personality style is going to be better with this salesperson, this one, you know, but I didn't ever look at it as anything other than just taking care of business.
God bless you, because I'm not. I'm trying to be like you when I grow up. I'm a Gemini, so I phase in and out of niceness, but that's definitely something to work towards. So you just had a birthday. And happy birthday again on the air. So you're another year older, another year wiser. So if you had a time machine, and you could go back and talk to your younger self, you know, without causing any paradoxes or cataclysms to the space-time continuum. Yes, I watched Doctor Who. Michelle got me into that. What are the top three things that you would tell your younger self to help prepare for your career?
To relax and to speak more slowly, and gosh, what else would I say to my younger self? I think in my younger years, I was so passionate, like to the point where work was everything, and I was the super career, where you know, I would, and I was always trying to do everything, work full time, go to school, get my degree. You know, I wasn't whooping it up and, you know, having a ball, but I am where I am today because of hard work. But I would tell my younger self now just to relax, to be open to the organicness of the process. I was so intentional of, I'm going to work at this job. I'm going to stay here. I will only stay after I've accomplished certain things. And as I grew in digital marketing, things would come to me. Hi, Lorrie, we want you to teach a class at UCSB. And I go, I can't do that. And so if I could have prepped myself just to relax and know that things, you know, kind of organically evolve. I was trying so hard to drive things sometimes that I wasn't really able to be still and be mindful of the opportunities around me.
I dig that. Absolutely. Especially going through the program at Full Sail, the program is accelerated. And so you kind of have to kind of have your head down and drive hard. But it's a big mistake that a lot of people make. They don't actually take the time to form relationships with their professors. And I can tell you that's one of the best things that you can do for yourself, because when we wrote our book, Beyond Buzzwords, we actually got two chapters from professors. And so, yeah, you know, be about business and drive forward, but actually, you know, take time, build relationships, smell the roses. It will do you well. Yeah. So we're going to take a short break, and then when we get back, we're going to dive deeper with Lorrie Thomas Ross. So stick with me. In the last 3 months of the 2016 U.S. presidential election, fake news outperformed real news on Facebook. Now, don't worry. This is a podcast about marketing, not politics. But what I'm trying to pull out with that example is that most people can't call BS online when they see it. Now, this is in stark contrast to the whole un-college movement that favors finding information online, oftentimes for free, as opposed to paying for higher education. Now, that tactic can work, assuming you can call BS when you see it, which unfortunately, most people just can't. The ability to call BS online, what we call digital discernment, is a skill, which means that it can be learned. Go to bit.ly.com/DMD course to learn the skill of digital discernment. In this short course, taught by yours truly, I condense my over a decade of trial and error experience, as well as the skill I learned getting a degree in digital marketing for your benefit. Go to bit.ly.com/DMD course right now. That's bit.ly/D as in dog, M as in Mary, D as in dog course. And we're back. So, Lorrie, you, Gary V, and Tim Ferriss, or insert whichever thought leader if you're at a different conference, like Ann Hanley, Lynette Young, whoever, you're all chilling at the bar after a conference having a straight talk, no BS mini mastermind. What would you say is severely lacking from the professional digital marketing space, and how would you brainstorm about correcting it?
Well, number one, I would put a big dollop of coconut oil in whatever Tim Ferriss was drinking, because I totally read all his stuff and I think he's great. I actually saw him on an airplane once flying to Austin, and he was looking at me like, okay, who is this creepy woman who can't stop looking at me? I've met Ann Hanley before. I have a total girl crush on her. I aspire to be the female Gary Vee. He is so just raw, and I love how he talks about digital marketing, and they're all, you know, I would just be like, ah, you know, and like fake, you know, trying to like sneak selfies. But I would say, where's the heart? You know, you can talk about the data and the analytics and this and that and which tool and that tool. I am such a believer of work-life balance, which, you know, Tim Ferriss is a big advocate for. I just look at everything as like life could be really short. And maybe it's because I've lost both my dad and my stepfather, but I just look at life as this beautiful opportunity to be present, to be with others. And I look at the work I do, and it's funny, actually, one of our clients today, she's based in New York. I really grew my career in California. Her husband was my former boss 19 years ago. And that's the kind of thing I'll say to my team. And I'll go, look, guys, it's all relationships. You always do your best. You take care of people. You know, you do what you got to do. It's so important, even just with customers, to not just look at the transactions of business and this and that. And, you know, and yes, there's all these sexy tools and you can grow your email list. Doing it with real meaning and looking at the longevity of what you're doing, because you're going to burn out if you're just doing it for the numbers and just doing it for the, whether you're trying to sell the business or whatever. But there needs to be, it's in it. When I talk about health, I mean mental, spiritual, physical. And that's what I feel like is still lacking. And there seems to be people with my mindset might get thrown into the health and wellness bucket. And it's like, ah, okay, whatever. She's a little too touchy-feely woo-woo. But that's what I would be bringing to the bar conversation.
I dig that, because you're absolutely right. I named this podcast Marketing Disenchanted for a reason, because just pushing for those KPIs and all about the numbers, that's a surefire way to burn out quick. So without getting political, but by all means, express yourself. Being candid is the whole point of the podcast. What's your take on the whole fake news controversy / crackdown on Facebook? Because after the results of the election, Facebook CEO Mark Zuckerberg sort of played it off like, oh, it's highly unlikely that Facebook had anything to do with the outcome. And then when the numbers about how much fake news was on Facebook actually came out on BuzzFeed, he actually backtracked a little bit and was like, we're going to crack down on fake news and start a verification process. And, you know, Gemini that I am, I'm still in the process of landing on where I stand. Sometimes I'm straight First Amendment, like, no, Facebook is a platform only. They don't have any business sort trying to, you know, sort of say what's real and what's not. And on the other hand, Facebook is a digital property. And as a property owner, you are ultimately responsible for what goes on your property, be that digital or terrestrial. It's no different than if, let's say, you have a pool in your backyard and some knucklehead teenage kids hop your fence to go skinny dipping and one of them drowns. Right. They were trespassing. They hopped your fence. Doesn't matter. Happened on your property. You're responsible. So where do you sort of land on that?
I don't have, like you, I'm still doing my research and reading. And I agree there is a content crisis. And clearly this election showed that, you know, one candidate was pretty sure that they would win, and the content and it's just because of social media, you know, we are influenced by our peers, and if our peers are more likely to skew one way or the other, you're more likely to see that. It's created a very healthy conversation, and I see it both ways. Facebook is a platform, and I don't see, you know, I mean, the right to say what you say to certain degrees can't be overly controlled. But, you know, if there truly was a problem that they were aware of, then yes. And I just don't know if there's enough proof to say that they were aware of it. What this is going to do is continue to bring the issue up, and will the more the conversation continues, the more solutions will be presented to figure out what to do that still protects the rights of people, but also doesn't overly skew people one way or the other. It will be really interesting to see. And I continue to read. It's hard not to. So I wish I had I feel like I don't know what I don't know to some degree at this point.
Right. It's a pickle. It's a real pickle, because part of Facebook's algorithm and what makes it so compelling on Wall Street and the targeting is so good is that they can kind of hone in on what you like and show you more of what you like. Mm-hmm. But the rub comes in is that, you know, some of what you believe and what's factual are two different things, right? So kind of like Neil deGrasse Tyson, he's like, I'm cool with religion. I'm fine with your belief. Where we have a problem is where you start prostituting your beliefs as facts, and they're not. So, it's a very interesting conversation, very interesting space. And like you, I'm just short of monitoring the space, and We'll see how it progresses, because I don't, it would be dishonest of me to say I actually knew how I felt just yet, because I don't. One last question, and I'll let you get on with your day, and I do appreciate you taking the time. And I am going to take just a few minutes to set the question up, because I really want you to understand, you know, where I'm going and why I'm asking it the way I'm asking it. It's a modified version of the last question that John Lee Dumas asked on his Entrepreneur on Fire podcast, because in my personal and professional opinion, there's a severe gap in the professional digital marketing education space in terms of career trajectory. And by professional, I mean someone who works in-house at a corporation or brand or works at an agency. I am not referring to digital entrepreneurship or solopreneurs, somebody like a Pat Flynn or John Lee Dumas, even though you could absolutely make the case they're professionals because they operate at such a high level. That's not who I'm talking about. I'm talking about people with jobs, people who get a W-2 or a 1099 at the end of the year, right? And so just using my own journey as an analog, you start off sort of meandering the wilds of Google for a year or 10. And you, there's some good information out there, but it takes a little bit of doing to root it out. You might land on a good source like lynda.com, where I first discovered you. You might end up doing Amway and Mary Kay. Like, who knows where you're going to land, right? And so after that, at some point, you get serious and you decide to jump. And at that point, when you're ready to invest, you kind of have two options. First option is you can do what I did and go back to school and get a degree in internet marketing. The problem with that is that it's very expensive. I had to borrow the better part of $60,000 to get my bachelor's. Plus, it's time consuming. Even though my degree program was accelerated, it still took 30 months to complete, and a lot can happen in the online space in 30 months. But by far the most prevalent way that the industry educates itself and disseminates best-in-class practices is through conferences and seminars. The problem with that is that even though in aggregate it's a lot less than getting a degree, you have to have the money up front. So take some of your top tier conferences like a South by Southwest, a Marketing Profs B2B Forum, or MozCon. You're looking at between $500 and $1,500 just to get through the door. That doesn't include your flight, your hotel, food for however many days, Uber. No, just to have your plate face in that place, $500 to $1,500. After you add all that other stuff back in, you're easily looking at between $3,000 and $5,000 on a single conference. And that doesn't include any upsells from the stage for any, you know, private VIP coaching programs or masterminds. And they can range from $10,000 and up, in my opinion, in my experience. Mm-hmm. So, what I'm trying to do is sort of crowdsource a way for people to professionalize themselves that doesn't include rolling the dice on Google, selling your firstborn to the Department of Education, or having to raise $3,000 to $5,000 to attend a conference. So now that I'm done setting that up, the actual question is, imagine you woke up in a brand new world, identical to Earth, but you knew no one. You still have all the experience, skill, and knowledge you currently have, your food and shelter taken care of, but all you have is a laptop and no money. That's right, you are college freshman broke, baby. You got somewhere to lay your head, a meal plan, computer Wi-Fi, and that's it. How would you build relationships with industry thought leaders over the next 30 days by working for free?
I would start by giving to gain. Nobody is entitled. And that is one thing I have found. And I will preface it. I came into the digital marketing world by accident. I mean, like, the first two times was actually pulled in, was like, I don't know if this is for me. And there were no classes. There were hardly any books. I mean, there was really nothing. And there was no Google, right? So it was, you know, me writing down acronyms like CPA, CPC, CPM, CTR, and finding the nicest looking geeks at my corporation and going like, hey, this is totally embarrassing, but I totally need you to tell me what these are. So, like, you know, I can, like, get through the rest of my workday. And I learned by doing. I'm a big believer in experiential learning. Getting the framework would have certainly accelerated the process. What I did get, and my biggest gift, was that I knew how to hustle. I worked for multiple retail chains, but my last retail stint was at a high-end luxury department store. And let me tell you, expensive stuff does not sell itself, okay? Mm-hmm. You got to dial for dollars, and you pick up the phone. This is before email, and I was, you know, remembering people's kids' names and holidays, and, oh, didn't you say you had another house? You know, we could actually go ahead and ship that for you. It was all about service, 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 service. Everything I've ever done professionally has a service backbone. So going back to sucks to be me, I've got nothing but a laptop, how do I start connecting? I look at how can I help others? What can I do to help them out? And whether I'm cultivating content and I'm crediting them, or I'm, you know, blogging, you can do that for free. But as you are endorsing other people and saying so-and-so wrote something, you go from being an expert to being an authority by simply offering content. So I would certainly become a web gemologist and start sharing content and crediting people and reaching out, but also taking the time to personally connect. I had a kind of a, you know, tough love conversation with one of my friends who had recently relocated, and she said, I'm going to do a blast to my email list and let my whole list know I've relocated. And I said, well, if you relocated and your business is virtual, in her case, she's a web-based business, it was, I said, why don't you hand message people, hi, personal person's name, I just wanted to let you know, and make it personal. I mean, I've reached out to some big name authors before, and I've done it in a way that's meaningful, and something that wasn't robotic and wasn't like a big email blast, but something that was, here's what I can do for you. Hi, I just read your book. The part about blah, blah, blah really spoke to me, right? Like taking the time to make a little effort and show that it's not just hi. But I will say that there is a lot of what can people do for me? And I always turn it around with what could I do for them? Whether it's, I would really like to interview you for a class I'm taking, or I would like to blah, blah, blah for you, or, you know, whatever it is. But I'm always looking at what I can do. And if you've got no money and you got no job and you're trying to get work in certain areas, and some experts will completely disagree with me, I say work for free. People say, I don't have experience, but I've got the backbone, I've got the educational foundation. Great. If your mom's brother's cousin has a business who's willing to let you do some stuff, do it, kick ass. And there is sometimes that attitude of like, well, I'm doing it for free. Mm-mm. You do it like you are getting paid $1 million. You do it 110%. You rock the heck out of it. You get that testimonial. And I mean, in my past, I've done projects where I have gone above and beyond. I've had to foot the bill. Sometimes I've had to pay my own web designers to do projects. And I'll say at the end of the project, you know, here's what we've done, and, you know, we'd love to use you as a reference. And if people ask how'd it go, I said, can we agree that you won't mention that, you know, we did this for free? And again, this is in the very beginning of my work. I also would do a lot of free speaking, and I would go up to conferences and say, I see you're doing a women's expo. I am an expert in da-da-da. I see that your speakers are in multiple areas of sales and marketing. Here's one area that you haven't covered yet. Here's where I can fill in. Again, you, in the name of the game of sales, and whether you're selling yourself or selling your next project, you have to fill that gap. And just to say, my name is Lorrie and I'm a speaker, I can speak at your conference, you're making that person do too much bleeping work. You gotta say, I've done all the homework for you. Here's how I can make your life easier. I mean, you think I got on lynda.com by them approaching me? Hell no. I still have emails from like 2006 where they said, we don't do marketing courses, thank you very much. And I would remember who might know so-and-so, who might know so-and-so, and I'd write emails very thoughtfully, knowing darn well that they might get forwarded to the right person. But it was always done in a very thoughtful way that would compliment. It wasn't just this blanket, hey, figure it out for me. You know, it was, here's what I can do for you. And that is also critical in business, is that you have to spell it out. And I am going to stereotype right here. Okay, disclaimer, I'm stereotyping right now. Women are usually worse at this than men. And this is from my 11 years of having my own business where I support entrepreneurs. I will say, have you approached so-and-so? Yes. Send me a copy of the email you sent them. It's a lot of the times it's too passive. And I imagine this just ginormous mallet where you have to whomp people over the head. And sometimes on email and verbally and with a voicemail follow-up, assuming that people don't always catch all the communications, but you really have to say, hey, so-and-so, here's what I can do. Here's examples of my success doing it before. I'd love to do this, da-da-da. And be prepared that you're going to hear no quite a bit, but there's a give to gain, offer to do something of service. If you can do it just to get the experience and build and gain, great. If you can do things creatively, like in my case, I am missing the I fear public speaking gene. So I volunteered everywhere to speak for free. And that was my big introduction into getting exposure and getting clients and led to more teaching work. Do what you can do, whether you're willing to write, I'm willing to cover your event. I have background as a photojournalist. I see that you're doing an event coming up. I would be happy to do your photography pro bono and do some social media for you if you're interested, da da da. But find ways to kind of slot yourself in and be creative. You have to, I'm very comfortable making something out of nothing. That does not scare me. What scares me is starving. And I will wrap up by saying that I also in my life have never had a safety net. I put myself through college, was on my own at 18. I never had, whether it was a spouse or anyone, and even in marriage, I've never inconvenienced a spouse asking for money to start a business. I have always paid my own way. And to me, failure is more scary. But when you know what you can do and you believe in what you can do, going out and creating connections and sometimes start small and snowball. And that's a nice way to think of this too, is that you don't have to reach out to Gary Vaynerchuk to get help. Okay. Gary's busy, right? These people are like, whatever. It's like you and the rest of the world. Good luck. You all go after that 10,000 pound gorilla. Make smaller connections. I've often reach out to the smaller conference, reach out to the one that, isn't looking for the, big headline speaker, and start small and kick ass and build the relationship and use that to grow and grow. But there's money out there in all sorts of industries. And no matter what area of digital marketing you're in, there's always an opportunity to help people and help them do whatever they're doing better. And that's one other thing too, is that you can say, hey, I recently was on your website, love what you're doing. Compliments can get you far if they're genuine. I noticed that there were some opportunities from whether it's a search perspective or from an online advertising perspective or a social media perspective that you really are missing out on and that are untapped. Here's what I can do, and here's my background, and also establish a little credibility. I have experience working with small to mid-sized companies doing da da da. It's the service. It's the outreach, and that's hard for a lot of people. It's just that fear of like, I don't want to seem salesy. You're not. You're just educating.
I hope y'all are taking as much notes as I was, because you just got a master's class. That was phenomenal. Lorrie, thank you so much for that. This has been tremendous. Please tell us about Wild Web Women. Tell us about any products, books, courses you have. Where can we get a hold of you on social media? How can we get some more of your awesomeness?
Ah, you're so sweet. You can Google me, Lorrie Thomas Ross. I have an agency called Web Marketing Therapy, and you can follow us there or follow me on my personal accounts and either website, webmarketingtherapy.com or lorriethomas.com. And for any women listening, I attended a conference last year, spoke on social media marketing and personal branding. And at the end of the event, all the hands went up, and it was a women's specific event. And I was asked about How do I pound the pavement and drum up business? How do I sell without feeling like a used car salesperson? How do I get my spouse to be supportive? How do I juggle work, life, and kids? And you know, how do I blah, blah, blah. And I got back to the hotel room and I said to my husband, holy moly, I spent the majority of the Q&A talking about operations and administrative, like unsexy stuff, right? Go back to the beginning of our interview with like relationships. There's the unsexy stuff that you got to do. And even though I know sales and marketing, I just thought, oh my gosh, there's a huge void to support women. So Wild Web Women, you can go to wildwebwomen.com, is a community for women with web-based business. And it's not just the, here's the cool tutorial and here's how you make your site more friendly in search engines or whatever course we're teaching. But it's also, there's a membership opportunity where you need that like 911, my client's being a hole and I need to reach out to someone so I handle this without, you know, throwing myself, you know, out there. And there's a huge void for support. And just having accessibility and affordable accessibility to experts who have lived it, done it. And so we're creating a whole community to support and empower women. I could not do what I do. I have a 5-year-old. I work from home. All of my employees are virtual. We all have chosen certain areas around the country that we love to live. We're a lifestyle company. I want to help more women be happy and healthy and wealthy all at the same time. You can also find me on lynda.com. And I have a book through McGraw-Hill called The 36-Hour Course to Online Marketing.
And because Lorrie is a dear, dear friend of the show, she actually wrote the foreword to our book, Beyond Buzzwords, which you guys can get at thinkbeyondbuzzwords.com and on Amazon. We have a standing offer to all members of Wild Web Women. If you would like to be on the show, you're welcome. This is a new podcast. I can't say that I have a billion downloads every month like John Lee Dumas or anything like that. But, you know, you can use this as a digital asset. You have an embed code you can put on your website. And e casa es su casa. I'm saying that wrong, but you get what I mean. So, Lorrie, thanks again for everything. I greatly appreciate it.
Thank you.
If you've enjoyed this episode of the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, consider becoming a patron at patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support helps with hosting the audio files, upgrading audio equipment, and so much more. And between you and me, my pledge levels are killing them. If you go look at other people's pledges and come back and look at mine, I'm a professional marketer, so you know I like my swag. I got t-shirts, USB thumb drives, not to mention my awesome products. So go to patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support is greatly appreciated. Thank you for doing me the high honor of listening to the very end. Please subscribe in iTunes, Stitcher, or your favorite podcasting app. Leave a 5-star rating and write a review telling people about my unmitigated awesomeness. Really helps out with getting the show shown. Follow me on Twitter at Tembo8482. That's T-E-M-B as in boy, O-8482. Or connect on LinkedIn and I'll have my LinkedIn description in the show notes. And I'll see you next week.